2 मिनट सर, 1 मिनट।
या
आई थिंक नाउ यू कैन स्टार्ट।
ओके जोत्सना स्टार्ट।
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आईयूसीटी इंटर यूनिवर्सिटी सेंटर फॉर टीचर्स एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एजुकेशन दी महाराजा सयाजीराव यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ बड़ौदा आई डॉक्टर ज्योत्सना अमीन वेलकम्स यू ऑल टू टू डे नेशनल वेबिनार ऑन साइबोलॉजी फॉर 21st सेंचुरी क्लासरूम्स। एनी प्रोग्राम इज टू बी इनिशिएटेड विद द प्रेजेंस ऑफ गॉड ऑलमाइटी। नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर भूमिका बारोट असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एजुकेशन फॉर द इन्वोकेशन। डॉक्टर भूमिका।
थैंक यू डॉक्टर ज्योत्सना। या कुंदे नु तुषारे या सुप्रभास्त्रामृता या वी या श्वेत पद्मासना या ब्रह्मा च्युत प्रबोधिनी देवै सदा वंदिता सामां पातु सरस्वती भगवती
Thank you, Dr. Bhumika. Now I request the dynamic and proactive head, Department of Education, Coordinator IUCT, Professor R.C. Patel, sir, for the welcome address. Sir, over to you.
Good afternoon, namaskar, and welcome to all of you to this two-day initially planned as national but ultimately has converted into international webinar on cyberbullying for 21st century classroom. I take this opportunity to welcome you all to this great Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda and its Department of Education, which is one of the 111 departments of the Faculty of Education of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda. This department in fact was existing in the form of Secondary Teachers Training College since 1935. And in 1949, when university came into being, it became one of the two departments of the Faculty of Education and Psychology, and later on one more department was added. So at present in the Faculty of Education and Psychology, we have three departments, one of which is Department of Education, which has been raised to the highest status of Center of Advanced Study in Education by UGC. It has also been identified as the monitoring institution for the supervision and monitoring of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan in selected districts of Gujarat and Union Territory of Div and Daman. It also has been identified as one of the two IASs in the state of Gujarat. And recently in December 2017, the HRD Ministry has identified our department as Inter-University Center for Teachers Education. At present in our country, there are only two IUCTs, that is Inter-University Center for Teachers Education. So I take this opportunity to welcome you all. And my special welcome to Dr. V.P. Joshit, our resource person for today. Sir, welcome to this MS University and welcome to this webinar. Once again, I take this opportunity to welcome you all. Thank you very much.
Now I request Professor Sujata Srivastav, Professor in Education, Associate Coordinator, IUCT, to brief us about the seminar. Madam.
Thank you, Jyotsna. Professor R.C. Patel, Coordinator, Inter-University Center for Teachers Education. Our resource person for today, Dr. V.P. Joshit, our organizing committee members and dear participants. The theme of our webinar is Cybergogy in the 21st Century Classrooms. Cybergogy, an approach to learning, is not new. It has been in the education literature for quite some time now. However, it has suddenly shot into prominence in India and outside during this lockdown period. The focus of Cybergogy is technology-enabled learning in a virtual environment, combining the fundamentals of pedagogy and andragogy. It aims at learning that is independent, learning that is collaborative for the young and the adults alike. The heart and soul of Cybergogy is how do we engage the learners? The Cybergogy for Engaged Learning model of Wang and Kang, interestingly, talks about the critical factors in the cognitive, emotive, and social domains of the learners that have to be attended to for learner engagement. The emotional connect, the emotive state, the social interactions, easily addressed in offline teaching learning, requires serious consideration in the virtual mode. All this is required to motivate the learner, and the outcome would be engagement. What digital tools would create online communities, build social relationships for collaborative learning? And what are the tools for reassessment that could support high order thinking skills? How do we create and use videos and mobile apps to sustain learner interest and promote self-learning? Keeping this all in mind, our experts today and tomorrow would talk on web tools for video creation, web tools for e-assessment, web tools for collaborative learning, and mobile applications for education. And with this, I hand over to Dr. Jyotsna Amin to conduct the first session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I think sir is joining, Professor Parimal Vyas, sir.
Yes. Sir, welcome. Namaskar. Thank you.
Welcome, sir. Dear participants, we have with us our very proactive and dynamic Vice Chancellor, Professor Parimal Vyas, sir. And I welcome you, sir. And sir is always been a pillar of support and cooperation to all of us. And in his tenure, university has been accredited by NAC, A grade by NAC. University is, has enabled the Wi-Fi campus. And recently, the university has launched with the LMS Moodle of its own. So there are many achievements. And you may be surprised to know that sir is having a dual professorship. That is the unique thing for him. So we welcome you all for this webinar. And
thank you. Thank you.
I request you to address the gathering, sir. Thank you, sir.
Oh, sorry, there was some technical hinges, but then finally, I tried on my laptop. Finally, today is the first time I'm using my desktop now. Anyhow, I could reach to all of you. Technology always, makes us to learn something new. And sometimes we don't know how we have reached, but then ultimately we reach, we are passing through transition. And I'm very happy, my congratulations to the team of Faculty of Education and Psychology. Professor R.C. Patel, if you normally take a quiz in the university setup, they know about cyber security, they know about cyber laws, but if you ask them to talk about Cybergogy, they will not understand. I don't think this is quite new and interesting for many of the faculty members. And this new normal which we are facing, I think the life would not be different. And I'm reading one very interesting article for last 2 days. There's a debate going on in one of the platform where I'm a very active member. And the theme on which we are discussing is known as the death of a teacher. I really don't know what will turn out, post-COVID. But then this is very interesting, and I'm very happy Dr. Joseph from, I'm sorry, I joined you late, but I believe resource persons are with you.
Yes.
And we have Dr. K. Thiagusuri, he's also, I think both of them, I believe they are experts in this two-day Cyber Gogi for 21st century. Basically, what I understand is that you're going to talk about the technological tools, the kind of a classroom that we are going to have in today's seminar, or what we call it as webinar. And I'm very happy that more than 300 participants have joined. I'm not aware of how many of them are from our university. Professor Arsi Patel, I'll be keen to know how many of our own participants, our own faculties have joined, because that is what matters us a lot. See, I believe you have kept how many, 10 minutes for me, no? So I can for 10 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
No, let me, because I don't want to disturb your, webinar. And I really do not want to make even generic comment also. But this is a very, very important topic, and it provided me an opportunity to develop some understanding about Cyber Gogi. And we know, I think before the COVID, our understanding about ICT was, let me be very honest, when you say, are you using ICT in your faculty or in your college or university department? Or we would ask, do you have a smart classroom? Maybe you will be having a LCD mounted projector with whiteboard, and then you use. That is what we understand. That is what we call it as smart classroom. But I when you look at the area on which you're going to discuss, I understand the Cyber Gogi model, which has three overlapping domains, cognitive, emotional, and social. And with the rise of connectivity, seamless networking and education, whether we like it or not, but then the world would be very, very different. And what I understand is that we really need to change the mindset. We teachers, we really need to change our mindset. I'm after having made some attempt to understand about the theme on which you're going to discuss. As a professor of management, I say that yes, we are dealing with what we call it as the millennials. You know, there are different groups, and we talk about millennials. Professor Patel, we are dealing with millennials, all those young generation who are born on and after certain number of years. We also talked about Generation Z, and now we are talking about after 2010, we are talking about Generation Alpha. I could see where I stay, my neighborhood, a small child, and the grandpa has to put in a lot of efforts to make that child understand better. This is not good. You should not use this. But then I remember when we were small, probably we in fact had different set of a lifestyle as kids. And today the kids where they spend their time, I believe for them, iPad, 3D television, Instagram, and all other applications now with, for music and so many other applications. Even schools have started, imparting education to the kids, using online classrooms. And I'm very, very happy, because when you were discussing about the theme of the this webinar, you have tried to relate it with the 21st century. I think that is good, because in 21st century, we need to look at what skills that we in fact need to have today. And repeatedly, Professor Patel, because you have a center of teachers education, I am not sure, but I'm developing a feeling where we have become, over a period of time in our country, we have become so much examination oriented that today also, if you look at the results that has come yesterday, 12th of science, I believe examination to me should become a fun, learning should become a fun, but the kind of a social system that we have created in our country is that we look at everything, we measure everything in terms of either GPA or SGPA or whatever respective grade that somebody gets. And this skill part, except memorizing, there are a couple of movies that we all had seen, you know, which has very, very humorously, which has demonstrated that we are not emphasizing on skills. And I believe in 21st century, we need to put focus on four kinds of skills. The most important one, I think there's a debate on these two words which I'm going to use, is one is the creativity and the another is the innovativeness. To me, as far as I understand, the Harvard School of Psychology has proved already that all of us are creative, all of us. But I believe all of us are not innovative, out-of-box thinking that we really need to have. So creativity is looking for new ways. I also distinguish and I differentiate between the new and innovative. Whenever even you change, for example, now you take examination, the day before yesterday, I was addressing to another group of participants, where I would say the entire concept of education, the entire concept of examination has to undergo a paradigm shift. Professor Patel, you know, we've been discussing a lot, probably this is the time through which we are all passing, and students, we keep on reading that yes, certain universities started to conduct online examinations, open book examinations. If you ask me very honestly, I believe that we should leave it between the teacher and the student. We have unnecessarily standardized so many, you know, processes of the examination for our administrative convenience and so on and so forth. And probably creativity has been adversely affected. Second, is that if you're talking about creativity, critical thinking, I believe, how do you process, how our children, they process, how our students, they analyze information, and maybe we are not what we call the critical claims that the students make or somebody. This is the problem with our process of acculturation, socialization. We have to appreciate, we have to recognize, and I would say rather, we have to reward constructive criticism if it comes to. That is the need of the our communication. We know, probably earlier, when our generation, we used to write. Now I think that also, that skill also we are losing seriously. Communication is the third skill. And fourth, which I believe that would go very closely with what the theme that you're going to take up is the 21st century, is the collaboration. Skills. I think this was never the case. Maybe how do you decide the size of a class? And how do you standardize? Maybe I cannot make a comment because I know that the experts of education and psychology are here. But how do you decide the size of class? To an extent that I would say that, how do we decide the furniture, the infrastructure of a classroom? That also requires a lot of science. Anyhow, that is not. But I would expect when the experts are here, at least faculty of education and psychology should become a model to guide all other faculties that, oh, this is the kind of a digital classroom that we should have with this kind of infrastructure. It is the bare minimum expectation that I'm carrying out of this webinar. But by collaboration, I mean to say that we will have to make our students learn to work together. And I think that comparison and competition kills everything. Each one of our students is trying to be. I believe even if we want to be a good researcher, I would say that all our scholars, they have to sit together, share, talk, and then probably they can contribute. And this 21st century skills, apart from that, what kind of methodologies that are going to evolve? I believe this requires, I'm sure experts will talk about it. I really do not want to talk about it, but we all have started talking flipped classroom. Project-based learning, cooperative learning, game. I think we can use games. We find couple of, I think, how can we make it more interesting and innovative? By using games. I believe that experiment, problem-based learning, this is very, very interesting. Can we make a list of problems that are being faced by a region, by a locality, by a district, city, and then we try to relate it. Another, I would say that in 21st century, what I understand is that imagination, because we're talking about creativity, innovativeness, design thinking is going to play a very, very big role. Now, I believe it is normally unheard of in our higher education. Or we can also, we will also need to talk about what you call thinking-based learning. These are the, and then I believe that each and every student which we get, each and every child which we get, I always tell them that you are all original. God has made you original. And for that competency-based learning, each and every student, I think, I do not know, Professor Arsi Patel, I had received, I have read couple of emails, couple of reports where they never give zero. Student has attended. When you conduct the examination, they say, how can you give zero? We can never give zero mark to a student. That again collaborates with what I said, you know, that we have become too much examination oriented. And let me say, if I put 30 years or 35 years in a particular subject, I expect that I evaluate students with my level of competence. I think there's a complete mismatch. A student who has studied for 4 months, 6 months, 8 months, and if I've taught for 25, 30 years, I expect him to reach and bridge that gap within a couple of months. It's not possible. We need a paradigm shift, and I'm not sure, but I'm confident that the experts would guide us not only just how to use technology, but what are the other aspects, you know, which are more important, you know, for making this education very, very interesting, innovative, and it should become a part of fun. Instruction has to be student-centered. I think I really don't want to make comment because everybody knows about the way we design syllabus. I'm very happy for the first time, though there is a lot of, you know, lot of resistance. But when I said a question paper, I think I should be able to answer. I should be able to respond that out of 10 questions which I have asked, how many of them are of a normal, moderate difficulty? How many of them are of the higher difficulty? We all talk about now, you know, NEC and all, where we have started talking about designing the objectives, mapping of objectives and all that. But I believe whether we like it or not, that's very, very important. And then education, we should also, apart from the course-based outcome that we expect, we have to see that how can we inculcate citizenship. Our connect with the society is extremely important. So that is very, very important. I know that technology would be distracting. It is expensive. We are heading towards the digital textbooks. We are going to talk about 3D printing. We are going to talk about use of data analytics in higher education and so on. We are also we're talking about virtual and augmented reality. I'm very happy for the first time our university, probably we are the first one. There might be some private university, I'm not sure. But about 150 teachers of our university, they have joined that Moodle learning management system. I think that's great. I'm very happy, but then I believe each and every teacher, when we recruit and before we, I would say that before even a teacher is recruited and confirmed on a permanent basis, we have to ensure that what kind of set of skills he or she has acquired. I think Professor Patel, I would request you that the entire, that 10 days workshop, convert it into a 1 month. Put it as 1 month. Design the kind of webinars and workshops and the right kind of skill set. Because I'll tell you, I have the information from your faculty. All newly recruited teachers, I will put them in your faculty for 1 month. And you, with your team, with the support that you have, give me a complete model so that 1 month, when they come out of 1 month, they are completely, totally transformed. I think this is a spontaneous thought that has come to my mind, because in the initial phase, if you don't inculcate these skills in them, these mindsets which will have to change, it is difficult over a period of time. And I think we are all under the influence of artificial intelligence, machine learning, and I'm not sure, but we are heading all towards new kind of certifications and degrees. We're all talking about value-based courses. I believe how far we would be able to offer. Another expectation which I have from your faculty is that your faculty should take lead and see to it all of the faculty members. You make them learn, you make them understand, you make them to work on developing the e-content. This is what I want. If this can happen, it can happen only with the support of Faculty of Education and Psychology. Please don't expect any other faculty. It's in your domain, so I want that this e-content development, whatever support you're already having, a good support of MHRD, but at least to start, let us identify some teachers, at least we invite group of teachers where they want to learn, they want to develop e-content, MOOC courses. And another last, I don't want to overshoot time, but the last expectation which I have, that's the reason I wanted to be with all of you in this webinar, which is very interesting. I think the first webinar, which is very, very interesting, which talks about future, is that Professor Patel, I'll try to recollect, but there's another small expectation which I have from your faculty is that, we also need to, as I have told you in person, but I want you to conduct a couple of webinars on how to write a research paper, how to prepare a research proposal, yeah. What are the funding agencies which are available. I believe these are all the questions. Once I'll tell you, we inculcate these kind of values in our teachers, the younger ones. I believe we wouldn't get result, Professor Patel, within a year or two. But I believe in time to come, another after 5 years, 10 years, we'll find that our teachers, they are well equipped with necessary skills. We really need to expose them. I'll tell you, Professor Patel, that there are a couple of faculties and the universities of education and education, not the psychology, because psychology is something which we only have in our university. I have come across the Faculty of Education, the Department of Education has set up a Center of Artificial Intelligence. This is my expectation from the team of the entire Faculty of Education, that when it is not science, it's not technology, I want these, your faculty, you should give me a proposal for setting up Center of Artificial Intelligence. And I believe, not to become critical of what you do, because I'm nobody to make comment on your domain, but if at all we want to strengthen interdisciplinary research in our university, if you want to talk about credit transfer, making teachers understand to go and get through add-on courses, if we want our teachers to tell you that how they would develop and download and be prepared with the all kinds of e-resources before they start their next session, all this can happen from the Faculty of Education and Psychology. So I'm sorry, I really don't mean to hurt anybody, but these are my expectations, and I believe you, your faculty, and Professor Arsif Patel, you in particular, can make a difference to the entire university. I want this to happen, and that is why I thought publicly, let me request, Professor Patel, we discuss it when we meet, but when your entire team is here with the webinar, I thought this is the right time to tell all other participants of MS that your life is going to become very, very difficult. We are on the other side of fence. Another 5 years, 10 years, we will be not only enjoying whatever that the God was, kind enough, but you would not be able to survive and swim with the water, which will make you to feel a lot of heat. The mid-generation or those teachers who join, and they're all blessed. I really don't want to use anything. It is not, but this COVID has given us a wonderful opportunity.
Yeah.
And networking. So I wish all those who are part of your, that is why specifically I wanted to know that how many teachers of the MS University of Baroda has joined this? How many faculties have you are representing? Because when you put efforts, I would like to evaluate it very critically, that how many teachers of our own university from faculties, they are participating, because when we are conducting, if it is not, then please, we will make it mandatory and we'll conduct for them. But then we have to very, very critically review the participation of local teachers when they are free sitting at home with all kinds of luxury at their end, they must participate. So my best wishes to all of you. I'm looking forward for reflections of the participants from these 2-day workshop. And I'm expecting many more webinars from your faculty, and whatever support that you expect from university, we are always there with you. My heartiest congratulations to all of you. And I will switch off my camera, but certainly I would be listening to the expert talk. I'm in office and I'm quite comfortable. And I believe there is no age for learning. All of us should learn continuously. My best wishes to each and every one of you. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I hope this is the beginning in the right direction by your faculty. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Your words have set the tone for the seminar. Now I request Professor Sujata Srivastava to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you, Jyotsna. I take this opportunity to thank the Honorable Vice Chancellor of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, Professor Parimal Vyas. Sir, thank you so much for encouraging us in all our academic endeavors. And we really appreciate your persistent efforts to share the space with us in spite of facing technical glitches. Thank you so much, sir. It really means that you wanted to be here with the bottom of your heart. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. We have with us Professor R.C. Patel, who's the head Department of Education, Dean, Faculty of Education and Psychology, and the coordinator of IUCTE, that is the Inter-University Center for Teachers Education. He's always been a motivating force behind all the efforts that we make, behind all the initiatives that we take. So thank you so much. And he's always brimming with new ideas. I would really like to share this with you. So thank you once again. A very special thanks to our resource person who has joined us today. And for today, that is Dr. V.P. Joshi. He's from the School of Education, Central University of Kerala. Thank you so much, Dr. V.P. Joshi, for your valuable time. A very special thanks to our organizing committee. We have Dr. Jyotsna Amin, Dr. Bhumika Barot, Dr. Bhavin Chauhan, and research scholar Shefali Thimber. And all of them are from our own very Department of Education, Faculty of Education and Psychology. And I must share with you that they have been working day in and day out, you know, to make today happen. So thank you so much, our organizing committee team. Thanks goes out to our IUCT team, our programs officer, Dr. Jenna, and a very special thanks to Dr. Aruna Anand from the Faculty of Technology and Engineering for making this whole thing so smooth and effective. Thank you so much. And now I hand over to Dr. Jyotsna Amin.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I request Dr. Bhumika Barot to introduce the resource person of the day. Bhumika.
Thank you, Dr. Jyotsna. Good afternoon, all. Today we have with us Dr. V.P. Joshi. Dr. Joshi is a known name in the field of education and digital learning. With over 10 years of teaching experience, he is presently associated with Nagaland University as an associate professor in the Department of Teacher Education. He is also the recipient of the UGC Postdoctoral Research Award. He is an active member of many academic committees in the state of Kerala. He has completed two major and two minor research projects, which is funded by different agencies, including UGC. He has undertaken research in the area of MOOC, OER, and e-learning. Dr. Joshi is also a coordinator for MOOC course in UGC Swayam. I am happy to share you with that he has developed 32 e-content module in science education and also serve as subject expert for various MOOC courses offered through Swayam on different platforms like Outpeak and NIOS. He has to his credit more than 50 e-tutorials, which are available on various digital platform, learning platform. He has published 2 books and more than 40 research articles in journal of national and international repute. He has also provided his expertise as resource person in higher education for the e-content development project EPG Patsala of CIET, NCERT, NIOS, and many national agencies. Now, without further ado, I request the young and dynamic technocrat to start with our first session, which is on web tools for video creation. Dr. Jyotsna and Shefali Thimber, the research scholar, are here to provide you any assistance in case if you require. Now, I request you to take over the session. Thank you, Dr. Jyotsna.
Thank you, ma'am. The Honorable Vice Chancellor of MS University, Baroda, the coordinator and dean and head Patel sir, then the associate coordinator Sujata ma'am, my good friend Bhumika ma'am and Jolsina ma'am, and all other members in the organizing committee. Thank you very much for inviting me to this webinar. Today, I will be just talking on two important areas in e-learning or the online education which we are involved with. So the when you take this basic skeleton or basic thing in e-learning, it is the video which represents the faculty in that screen. So the first thing is that how you can create a video is very, very, very important. And all platforms, I'm very happy to hear that MS University has already installed Moodle. This is of the rarest kind because many of the universities do not have Moodle or even have their Moodle without functioning. So since you are working well on a learning management system, and it will be very beneficial for people like people in the field of technology to work with video creation tools. And two domains today I'll be talking about. One thing is that how you can create video, what are the available tools for video creation, and the other thing is that how you can go for e-assessment. So many different video creation tools are there. Just I'll be give the details of the video creation tools. I request the host to enable my screen sharing also. So we have video creation tools like Screencast-O-Matic. We have video creation tools like Screencastify, and we have video creation tools like Presentation Tube Recorder, and we have many different video creation tools. But when I speak out openly, all these tools will not give you a very long video for very high capacity because of the limitations that they have kept in their free version. So I'll be introducing to you one of the tool where how you can start with, that is you can start with one important tool which is known as Screencast-O-Matic, where you have some limitations on creating a video in the free version because the free version allows only 15 minutes video. And at the same time, I'll be giving you another important tool which is known as OBS Studio, and the OBS Studio will take over the limitations which we have in the free version of Screencast-O-Matic when we are recording. So two important tools that I'm going to discuss. Once again, requesting the host to make my screen sharing enable.
Joshit, so, sir, you have a share screen option over there, and you
there,
can
do
it from
there.
There
ma'am.
It's done. It's
not
done.
Enabled.
It's
now
done.
Only it is enabled.
Yeah, it's done.
Okay. So just I'm going with the what are the important video creation tools that we have. And we have the video creation tools, and those video creation tools we start with. We start with one simple tool which is known as Screencast-O-Matic. We have a quick recap of all the different tools available. Just few we are going to name. Another one is Screencastify, which will work as an add-on to Google Chrome. You have another tool, Presentation Tube Recorder. And I'll tell you, all these tools, previously all these tools working in a free domain with all those facilities. Now, as the number of audiences are getting enhanced, these tools are getting converted to the where it is in the paid form of the nature. Now, we are going with another one that is FreeCam. And we have another tool which is known as OBS Studio. We have another tool which is known as APowerSoft. So, and one more tool that I am going to present, which is known as ActivePresenter. So I'm just naming some of the important tools here. One is Screencast-O-Matic, screen castify. Third one I told, presentation tube recorder. Then we have FreeCam, we have APowerSoft, we have OBS Studio and many different tools. Now we will start with Screencast-O-Matic. So how you can download and install Screencast-O-Matic tool in your system, and you can start creating a video that we'll see. So first thing, you simply Google. Everything we starts with Googling. So you simply Google Screencast-O-Matic. So when you just simply Google it, Screencast-O-Matic, you can see the name Screencast-O-Matic. Never confuse with the spelling, because all these tools will be working with some or other specific nature. So when you simply Google out Screencast-O-Matic, you are getting an Screencast-O-Matic website, Screencast-O-Matic screen recorder and free video editor. This is the place which we want to go. So now here you can just see that first, if you are for the first time in Screencast-O-Matic, you have to go for sign up. It is every, now what happens to every system based applications is that rather than going for a cloud system based application, normally they go for a cloud based nature. So you have to sign up for the first time. And when you sign up, you can sign up with Google as usual, or you can sign up with any other email. Now, normally it asks your Google account, and here just it takes my Google account, which is seen in the screen. Now, after that, the Screencast-O-Matic will ask you for allowing some of their needs. That is how you can associate with them, how you can personally associate with Google and all. Only thing is that you can give allow. After allowing, it will be taken to the Screencast-O-Matic site. Now you see, there are three options in Screencast-O-Matic site. One is start recorder, second one is open video editor, and third one is download and install. See, I have just given a red square box here to download and install, because we need to go with this icon. So just click on download and install. The downloading will start, and after the downloading, the installation process will start. So as usual, you can keep next, you can agree with what it is asking, and all those procedure normally you do for every installation, you can do. So it will be getting installed as you see in my screen. Now finally, once it is installed, it asks for launch free recorder. Now see the screen. You are having a launch free recorder here. When you have the launch free recorder, now what happens here? You can start the free recorder, that is Screencast-O-Matic. Now, so again, what I have told you, I am just repeating the process once again. We are simply Googling out Screencast-O-Matic. It will take to the site where you need to sign up for the first time. And when you sign up, you'll have the screen where you will get an icon called download and install. You can click on download and install. It will be getting installed after giving the accepting the sequenced commands. Finally, it will go with launch free recorder. Now see what happens. When you start the recorder, see my screen. It is getting into a square box with dotted lines with a record option which is available here. And see the record option. What all things are there? You have three different options. One is screen, Second one is webcam. Third one is both. Now, if you want to start recording, see, you please understand that what and all in this dotted square box or rectangular box, it will get recorded. So what and all which is available in this dotted rectangular box will be getting recorded. So first, what you can do before launching your free recorder, just now I have told you how you can launch the free recorder. Just every time when you double click on the item, when you double click on the icon, it asks launch free recorder. Before launching, you make ready with your presentation slides which you want to record, or you make ready with the document that you want to record. So minimize the document here, minimize the document on the taskbar here, and after that you start your recording, means the start your screen customatic. Now three options are available. One thing you see as screen. Screen means only the screen will be recorded. Second thing you see as webcam. Webcam again shows your camera will be getting activated and it will get recorded. Just like we have the Zoom now. And the third one, you have both. You can use screen along with the laptop camera or the system-based camera. Now, what to do when you want to start record? First, you get ready with your slides, get ready with your presentation. Just now what I'm going to do, leaving away from my slide, I'm going with a direct screen. Now just I'm going with a direct screen. You can see how I'm working with the direct screen. So here, what happens here? Now I'm going with the direct screen. See, I'm taking screen customatic from the system. So I'm taking screen customatic from the system. You can see this one. I'm sharing my screen. I'm just taking my system here. So after taking this, after just going to my desktop, see the screen customatic icon here. This is a screen customatic icon. I just double click. Now it will get open. And what happens here is, yeah, normally while it is opening, it will ask for launch free recorder. Just I have told you. Now, yeah. So it needs some updation and all. Just we are leaving with the updation and all. Now, what it goes for recording, I'll tell you. We have the recording where we record with the screen, which is available here. We have started free recording. After that, we comes to the customized screen. After that, we are just getting ready to record and see the record button here. You can see the record button here. Now the recording process is going on. When you click on the recording button, the recording process will initiate. So when recording is going on, you see the changes will be there in every other area. When recording is going on, the changes will be there in the other area where you see now. You can have the, you can see the slideshow now where you will be having the changes. Now see, I am going to record a file. And while recording, what happens is that all these things are getting done. See, you have to start your recording. You have to start your recording. Now record has been started. So the narration and all other things will move from here. You can get a knowledge that recording is going on. Once you complete the record, once you complete the entire recording, please click on record once again. Please click on record once again. So what happens is that immediately it will ask for an icon. Like now see, we have recorded for 2 minutes. Now it will ask for an icon called done. You can click on done. When you click on done, automatically it asks a button whether we need to save or upload. You just click on save and upload. Now it moves to the other screen. What does the other screen say? Again, I'm repeating the process. Starting the recording, clicking on the red button. Now, the same process you continue, it will get stopped. Once the entire recording is over, you have to give done. When it gives done, or when you complete the process, it asks for the file. There you have to give save and upload. Now, when you click as save and upload, automatically it will ask to save as what? So here you give an icon, save as video file. See the things which I have given in the red box. So save as video file. When you save as video file, now here you should be very cautious. Please see the type. Please see the type. The file type will be MP4. File name, you can give any name here. Here I have given only recording. Or by default, it takes the name recording. Folder. Now please see the folder. Folder is desktop. Means the recorded things will be available in the desktop. Now other things you can leave it. Then you can click on publish. When you click on publish, automatically the recorded video will be starting to get published. See now 2% is over. It will complete 100%. After that, the video will get published like this. Once it completes, you can keep done so that you will see the video in the desktop finally. Now see the recording here. Now double click on the recording will start working. So this is a very simple process which I have told you related to, Screencast-O-Matic. But Screencast-O-Matic has got certain limitations. When you are adopting the free version of Screencast-O-Matic, only 15 minutes length video can be recorded by using this free version of the tool. If you are using paid version, again, it will give you n length videos because there is no restrictions there. And on the other side, paid version will allow you to give a chance to edit, especially what happens in video recording. In the case of video recording, we need to edit the front end as well as the back end. Because the front end, when you start, sometimes you have some disturbances. And when you finish also, sometimes you will be having some disturbances. So we need to edit those things. So these things can be done in the paid version. The editing can be done, adding effects can be done, and all other things which you can do in the paid version. But free version will have limitations. But even then, I'll tell you, when MOOCs or any other learning management systems, when it is considered, we have two types of videos. One video which works for a certain long length of time, which we call it as the content video. Another video which is used for advertisement, which we call it as the promo video. So see, promo video is only for around 3 to 5 minutes. Within that 3 to 5 minutes, you want to advertise the course that you are giving through online. This is our understanding. You want to advertise the course that we are offering online. Now, when you want to have such promos, or when frankly, as a teacher or as a learner, if you go for the first time before a camera, you don't find this so easy, or the task is so easy that you can do at any time. You need to comprehend certain techniques, and for those purposes, getting how you can train to get a good video understanding of screencast-o-matic. So I have told you, screencast-o-matic on its free version will give you 15 minutes long videos. Now, paid version, it will give any length of videos, no problem in that, but it has got around 2500 per year. So in this context, if you want to have both the content videos, and if you want to make the other video, means the promo video, we are going with a new video creation software, which is little complicated, but is very simple once you learn it. Now, when you do screencast-o-matic, you find that screencast-o-matic is very simple. Why? Because you have only the installation procedure, and directly you have two buttons. One button is recording, and another button is for conversion and all. Here you have many more additions which you can work on with a software, with a tool, which is known as OBS Studio. Now see, I'm going to present Open Broadcaster Software or OBS Studio to you. Again, what is the advantage of OBS Studio? OBS Studio will give you software, means will give you video. OBS Studio will give you video for any length of time in a free mode. You are not going to pay anything. You have to have some common sense in recording. What all things you need to do, what all things you should not do while working with the Open Broadcaster software. So I am going with the second video creation tool, which is known as Open Broadcaster Software or OBS Studio. Now see, the same process we do for installing. First, we simply Google OBS Studio in a new tab. Now, after Googling, you will be going to the website of OBS Studio. Now see, OBS, Open Broadcaster Software, we are going to this website. Now, when you go to this website, the homepage will be appearing like this. You have very simple homepage where you see Linux. See, in the previous software, when I was talking about screencast-o-matic, sometimes you would have got some problem with your operating system. Now see, here you don't have any problem with different operating system. We have Windows also, again, Windows supports 8 and above. We have Mac OS and the Linux. All these different versions of software are available in the OBS homepage. Now, in the case of Windows, first thing, you should be very familiar to understand what is your system property, in the sense that whether your system is 64 bit or 32 bit. 64 bit or 32 bit. For that purpose, what you can do? You can simply go to the control panel, see the system properties, control panel of your laptop or desktop, see the system properties. In the system properties, you will understand that whether your system belongs to 32 bit system or 64 bit. So normally when you click on Windows directly here, it will be going with 64 bit operating system. So what you have to do, you have to click on download. You see the different icon. Icon for Windows, icon for Mac and for Linux. You can click on the Windows icon. You can directly install the 64 bit. And just see the second one, it is for 32 bit. Those people who are using Windows operating system, little be cautious about which type of installer you want to use. For that purpose, you kindly go and understand what is your system property, and based on that, you need to install this software. And for others, Mac and Linux, you can directly click and install your software based on your operating system. Now what I'm telling, we are working with a software or a video creation tool. And that video creation tool, I told you, this is Open Broadcaster software. Just like the name says, it is open, it is free of cost. Now, I have told you two things. One thing I told that you should be very peculiar about the operating system that you are using and the concerned version that you have to select. Second thing, even you are using Windows, you should have to know the type of your system, the system properties that you want to know, so that you can select whether it is 64 bit or 32 bit. So these two things are clear. So after that, we will be going again for the installation purpose. Now, see again how you can install. So we are going with this thing where we have an installer which we have downloaded, and the downloaded installer starts installation. Now see, obviously for any other thing, it goes with the some checks and questions you have to give next. And again, it asks for license priority and all, you have to give yes. Now you'll see that it is getting in the C program files, obviously for other thing also. Now in that you have to give install, and finally you can keep a desktop icon and you can finish. So now once you finish, your screen will be directly like this. Your screen will be like this, where it asks two questions. This is what is the auto configuration wizard. The auto configuration wizard of the OBS Studio prompt you on two questions. The pop-up menu will ask you two questions. One is optimize for streaming, recording is secondary. What is the advantage? You can stream in the YouTube. While you are giving a video, while you are taking a session, you can go for direct streaming. Second one, optimize just for recording, I will not be streaming. So you use the first icon, that is you select the first one, optimize for streaming, recording is secondary, and give next. Now it asks for the version, base canvas resolution and all. You can keep the default, there is no problem in that, and you can give next. Now see the screen. I think you are getting a very black screen, and see this canvas. See, this is the square area which we will have the recording taking place. So this is the area where you want to put something, you want to give something, so that the recording will be doing in that screen. Now I'm going to explain very clearly on certain things. Be very cautious, because we have a screen and our screen has got a very clear black area, which I told that this is the area in which we will start recording. Now see the different icons here. See one window with the scenes. Please see the windows here on the left side bottom. One window with the scenes. Second window with the sources. Third window with audio mixer. Fourth window with scene transitions. And the last window with control. So see, what are the facilities that you have? You have scene, you have sources, you have audio mixer, you have scene transition, and finally you have control. Now I'll tell you an idea. You can just check whether your installed OBS software is working properly or not. So for that purpose, when you start speaking, see here, there is a mic auxiliary. There is an icon in the audio mixer, mic auxiliary. You can see mic auxiliary that will be getting, the waves will be getting reflected there. You can see the wave movement whenever you start speaking. And whenever you start speaking, when the wave movements are represented in the screen, means your OBS studio working properly. Your installation is complete and you can start with the recording initiation. Now, how we'll start recording? See, first one. For recording, you need to have scene. You have to have the recording on a scene and you need to have sources. Now, what I'll do here first, I will create one scene. Listen. I'm going with a very simple process. Very simple process. If somebody who is working along with me can also go with the same steps, you can see the changes, what is happening in your screen. The same changes will be reflected on this video also. So first icon, the first thing that which we are going to do is that we are going to create the scene. For creating the scene, what are you doing? You just go to scene. See the first one, scenes. We are going to scene. We go to a plus button. Here there is a plus button. You click on the plus button. When you click on the plus button, normally a pop-up menu comes, where you can see the default name of the scene as scene 2, because scene 1 already is there. So you simply click OK. So you understand that the scene has been added. See the screen. Previously, we have only one scene by default. Now we have added one more scene. How we have added? We have just clicked on the plus button here. Automatically the pop-up menu asks for the name of the scene. I didn't change anything. I just go with the default name. You can change if you wish. That is all up to you. The default name, which was taken as scene 2, I have given OK, and the scene 2 has been created. So our first idea, we have checked whether our OBS studio was working properly or not. How that we have done? Just I'm repeating once again. We have checked whether our OBS studio software is working properly or not. How that we have done? We have just checked by the waves which is reflected on the mic or axillary which is there in the third window. After that, what I have told? I have told we need to add scene. For what? We need to add scene for our recording. So the first thing is that we are going to add scene. So for that purpose, what we have done, just I'm repeating the process once again. For that purpose, we have just selected the scene. We have added plus, automatically scene came, and we have added scene to the screen. Now, the next thing is that we want to add sources. See here the second window which shows you sources. We want to add sources. So again, the process, the logic, everything same. So for this purpose, I'm going to click on plus. Automatically, what happened? Many different sources are available. See, we have sources like audio input capture, audio output capture, browser, many different sources. In that, I have selected video capture device. The source that I have selected is video capture device. See my screen. Video capture devices will be reflected in blue. Now see how it is changing. Just like in the previous case, they asked for the source name. Previously, what it has asked? It has asked about the scene name. Here it is asking about the source name. So by default, the name is coming here as video capture device, which I'm not going to change. If you want to change it as presenter or presentation or anything, you not going to change. I click OK. Now, see, when I click OK, what happens is that the camera, system camera opens, the laptop camera opens. And here, see my device camera is HP TrueVision HD. It got open. Now, all other things, configuration, everything will be there. I am simply clicking OK without doing anything. Automatically, you can see the view of the presenter in the screen. Now see. Now you can keep anywhere. Just drag from here. You can keep the presenter. Now for the first purpose, I have kept it as centralized. Now in the second case, see, I have kept it in a corner. Now, what we have done, I have done only one thing. Very simple process. I have added a scene. Simply what I have done, just I have taken a plus button under scene. I clicked on that. Then by default, scene name came. I just clicked on that, scene came to the screen. Second thing, I need to add sources. For that purpose, what I have done, I have just gone to sources. The same plus button is seen here. I click on the plus button. Then from that, different sources are listed. Among the different sources, I selected video capture device. Now, after selecting video capture device, your camera will get opened. So your scene will be coming on your screen. Now either you can centralize or you can keep it at any corner. So all these things can be done by dragging. Now I kept at the right end corner. Anywhere you can keep, there is no problem. Where you want to fix the presenter, you can fix accordingly. Now I have done sources one. Now what I want to do? I want to make display. Now presenter came. Presenter is in the scene, but remaining part, it is black. Presenter is there in the scene. remaining part where the recording happens is black. So I want to go with the next one. So I click on plus. I click on plus. Again, the different sources are listed out. When the different sources are listed out, from the different sources, I select display capture. From the different sources, I select display capture. Now, when display capture selected, again, by default, they ask for a new display capture, create a display capture. I didn't want to change anything. For example, if you want to change presenter, presentation, anything you can do. Here I have just kept it by default, display capture, and I click OK. The OK here I click. Now what happened? The display key. Don't get stared or don't get frightened with the display, because zoom in display is coming. A very large display that you are having, which is getting zoomed in. Now, you just click OK, again the display becomes stable. Now what happens, I'll tell you. When you are working with me, what is the problem? When the display comes in the screen, you should be very cautious. Previously what you have done, you have made the presenter in the screen or the presenter in the scene. Now what happens for the display? So display, I'll tell you, presenter was there in the scene correctly, and we have adjusted the presenter to the right and bottom. When display comes like a zoomed in display. So you will not see presenter, you will see display alone. So when you see, what happens is that the presenter will be, the presenter scene will be hidden. So for that purpose, what you have to do, just again go with the same thing. What I am doing here, see the display. Now I click OK. When I click OK, automatically what happens is that presenter will be absent in your scene, but this display will be present in the scene. Now what you have to do, you have to just see the scene. You have to drag display to the bottom so that you will see the presenter again. See, go to sources. Very clearly I'm saying go to sources. Just make display, just give preference to video capture so that display should be dragged to downwards so that the display will be there and video also will be there. So now you have video and you have display. Both things are available in your scene. Display and video, both things are available in your scene. So again, what we are doing? We are just working with display along with the presenter. Now again, we can see. We'll see how display and presenter both are working here. See, at this point, we have to go with the recording slides ready in our system. Now, I'll tell you once again, what all things you have to be very cautious. You see one scene here, you see one video capture device here, and you see one display capture here. You see the display, and on the one end, you see the presenter because you kept the presenter there. Now, just see the last end. You see the controls where you see start recording. Now, what you have to do? Now, I have told you already, you need to keep your slides ready in the taskbar for recording. Now, you can click start recording. You can click start recording and open your slides. You can click start recording and open your slides. So again, what you can do? You can click start recording and you can open your slides. So now, when I click on start recording, see, I have clicked on slides. So first thing what I have done, I click on start recording, then I click on slides. See, the slides are coming inside of this display. See, now you see the slides. Previously slides was not there. Just see the difference. See the screen. In the screen, there were no slides. Now what I have done, I have clicked on the slides which I have already kept in the taskbar. Now see the screen. My slides came into the display. Now slides are ready. Slides are ready. Your display and video is ready. Now you can click on start recording. See the start recording button. When you click on start recording, what happens is that recording starts. So that now you click on slides, put the slide in the display mode. See the process once again. See the process once again. I told you to keep the slides ready in your taskbar. After creating the presenter, after creating the display, next process is that you want to import slides to the display. Once slides are properly imported to the display, click on start recording. So the recording starts. When the recording starts, click on slides, put the slide. Normally when you click on slide, the slide will not be there in the display mode. You put the slide in the proper display mode, you start recording. Now you complete the process. Click on escape, come back to the display mode and stop recording. Click on stop recording. See, there is an icon which is called stop recording. The automatically the start recording icon will be converted to stop recording. Now after stopping your recording, your recording is over. After stopping your recording, you understand that your recording is over. So what we have done, we set a scene. After setting a scene, we set sources. In the sources, two things we set. What are those things? One is the presenter view. Another one is the display view. After creating there, I have told you some little problem which comes there. The problem is that when you keep display, presenter will not be seen in the screen. So what you have to do? You have to go to sources, keep presenter to the top. Drag and keep presenter to the top. You will see both presenter and the display in the scene. Now presenter is there, display is there. What is the next task? I have already told you, you have to keep your recording, means the presentation slides ready, which you want to record. So now you click on the slide in the taskbar, which is there in the bottom. When you click on the slide, what happens is that the slides will be imported to the display. Till that time, you will see that zoom in display, but you will not have any slides. The changeover you have to understand properly. When you click on slides, slides will be imported to the display. Now, slides are getting imported properly. So it is very good. Slides also came. Click on start recording, which is there in the control at the right side. When you click on start recording, immediately the recording starts. Now you click on the slide, which is there in the taskbar. Automatically the slide will come to your screen. Put the slide in the display mode and you can start recording. So when all your recordings are completed, click on escape button in your laptop. Now from the display mode, you will come out. Now you can take the OBS Studio, which is there in the taskbar, and click on stop recording. Now, this is a method which I have told you for a beginner, in the sense that you are new to OBS Studio. When you become confident on working with OBS Studio, we can avoid all these transitions and we can keep some keys which for start recording, stop recording, and for pause. So start recording can be kept it as a key, like a shift key can be used for start recording. So all things are ready, you click on shift, recording will start. And once everything is over, you click on some other key which you keep it as a key for the stop recording, the recording will over. So these also can be done later. So what I have told, now we have completed recording. Now I am going to present my screen where you have completed the recording. See, recording is stopped. Now what we want to do? We want to understand that where this file has been recorded or where this video has been recorded. So for that purpose, what we will do? We will just, again, I'll tell you one thing. You have to go to sources once again. You have to go to sources once again. Now this display, we want to stop. We want to make it as a simple display. For that purpose, what you can do? See, one eye near to the display capture in the sources, an icon of an eye, which is near to the display capture. You click on that eye, automatically the display will be stopped. Display will be stopped and you will see a black screen. If you want to stop the presenter also, you can just click on the eye. The presenter also will go. You will have the first customized black screen. Now I'm not going to that. I will just go how you can see the recorded video. Now see, go to the file. The file is there in the left top. Go to the file, click on show recordings. When you click on show recordings, automatically the videos which are recorded will be coming. Maybe this will be seen in, see the file path. Please see the file path, PC, desktop, videos. You have to ensure that where these recordings are there in your system. This is your understanding that I'm telling. You have to ensure that where the recorded videos will be available in your system. Now see, I have many different recorded videos. So I select the latest one, which has been done now. So the video is ready. Now I just select the video, which is getting played. So you see that the video is playing properly. Now, this is a process by which you record a video through OBS Studio. And I'm telling you, we have got lot of things. I'm just giving you one more thing related to this. We have got lot of advanced things which you can do with OBS, with free version. But once you get the knowledge of the basic, then only you can work on those things. Again, I'll tell you one thing. I'll just complete and I'll take the question. I'll tell you one thing. We have just recorded a video. I told that video can be for any long length of time. I told you we have worked on the basic version. Now see my screen. I have the curtain in my back. All these things can be made or all these things can be hidden using chroma key, green or something. All these facilities, the animations that you add, all these facilities can be done using OBS Studio. So with this, I stop with two softwares which we work for creating videos. So I may expect some questions from the participants. Welcome. So any question, ma'am?
Yes, sir. There are a few questions.
Yes, ma'am.
Sarika asked about if she has already recorded with some presentation. and then there are certain changes in the presentation.
Shefali, sorry to intervene. Dr. Joseph, at the bottom of your screen, you find Q&A.
Yeah.
There are 12 questions. You only can go, you read the question.
Okay, sir.
Joseph, sir, some of them have returned their questions in the chat also.
Yeah.
So you can but just scroll and... But
some of the questions are not exactly the questions.
Yes.
They have something like the chat they have given.
So basically, when you started with Screencast-O-Matic, initially...
I'll tell you. See, when you work on OBS Studio, when you work on ABS Studio, we will be giving you one more software, which I'm not going to give a trial now. I'll just give you one more software, which is known as OpenShot Editor. You can edit any video using OpenShot Editor, and you can add or blend anything. For example, if you want to add an image in between, if you want to add a soundtrack in between, if you want to add another video or blend another video, anything can be done using an editing software which is known as OpenShot Editor, and it is again free. It's an open source software. Now, what about the editing? I have told. Then, no audio and video. No, so the customized system audio will be taking for OBS. There is no problem. Whatever the audio that you are having, and you can see that it is working with the mic also. Mic will be, the waves will be just going up and down, which you can see. If the person who is seeing the recording, do they need to have same software? No. Whatever the recording you have, the video finally you make in MP4. The video mainly you make in MP4, I know any different format. Normally it comes as MP4. So the person, no need to have the OBS. They can have directly the MP4 thing. Yeah, if you have any other question, I'll be, OpenShot Editor is free. This is again a question. OpenShot Editor is free. Now, if you want any other question, I'll also answer. Those questions which I'm seeing, I have answered already. How to add audio in a presentation? Audio will be taken in two ways. One, the desktop audio, which you can take it as a thing, or the mic or the auxiliary you can use. So if you have a desktop audio, like something, some audio file is playing, you can take that desktop audio, or just like today what we are doing, we can take the mic. One question related to that. For recording, first we have to open the slides and then only recording. That's the thing I'll tell you. When you open the slides and you put it in the display mode, you will not see OBS again. So for that purpose, what we will do, we will keep some control. We will keep one control, like the keyboard, which we will keep some Alt plus A as starting or Alt plus E as ending, something like which you can keep. So that will work better than the previous transition. Otherwise, just start the recording, then take the slide, then put it in the display mode. This is the process. Mac also has got same OBS, no problem. The version is working properly. Then any other question? trimming can be done using OpenShot software. Trimming can be done.
May I request the participants to post the questions in the question answer box, not in the chat box.
So anything can be done. This is a very simple software. Only one thing I want to tell you. For example, we cannot go with always with paid softwares. And again, I'll tell you, when you work on a professional team, work with a professional team for creating a small video, I'm telling about a video with all those proper professional editing, you have to pay 5,000 plus. because they will edit with the Final Cut Pro software, or they will go with all standard formalities. And one more thing, when you edit with OpenShot also, you can keep the quality of the video high or moderate, anything you can choose. So OpenShot will give you an understanding on editing a video or multiple videos, or blending a video with audio, or blending an image with audio, anything free of cost. Finally, all trimming and all that we can do. And finally, we can export it as a video in all format. But only the problem which we felt in OpenShot is that conversion at the last stage, it will take time. Now, OBS, any question which I'm not answering means you can just ask me also. Yeah, Mac, you have the separate OBS for Mac. So there is no problem with the Mac also. Now, question answer session, should we have always laptop camera post? You can use other camera. See, if only one camera you have, this is a simple understanding. If only one camera you have, by default, the camera will come. When you click on the presenter view or presentation, the camera will come. If you have multiple camera, means other quality camera, which is inbuilt or which is external. Simple. Yeah, OBS supported animation video. It's clear. OBS have got all advanced features. It supported animation video. Now, OBS means open broadcaster software. Then editing software, which I have told you, that is open shot editor. Yeah. FreeCAM software also you can use many different. I have already told you can use many different softwares, but the problem is that all the softwares, they work in paid version. So since they work in paid version, they will have some features disabled in the free version. Screencast-O-Matic is a clear software. The problem is that the free version works for only 15 minutes. Then paid version of Screencast-O-Matic will work properly, but it costs around 2,500 per year. That will give you editing facility and the other animation facilities and other facilities also. By some moments, my screen sources and all editing windows mode, nothing to worry. You just close it. You just close it. You can start re-editing. You can start keeping the scene first. After that, you can go to sources. You can start keeping first the presentation source video. First you can keep, then you can keep the display. Now there is no synchronization for video and audio will be there in OBS. You just check with your mic. You just check, because whenever you start recording means your audio also will start. Audio also will start. And the synchronization with the video is that is how you manage with your slide. So the synchronization comes from our side. So there won't be any issue of synchronization by default, auto issue of synchronization, because we do make the synchronization. Yeah, one question came, how we can add music at the beginning and end. For that purpose, I have told you, you can work with OpenShot editor. The recorded video through OBS, you can bring in OpenShot editor. OpenShot editor will have different layers. You can add audio to one layer. If you want to add other thing, you can add to other layer. No, you, for the free version of Screencast-O-Matic, it is not working for one time. It works for any number of times. Only thing is that the size of the video will be very small. The times and all, every time you can open and you can do with a different video. So there is no problem in that. But the other thing, it will be, you can start streaming in OBS. A good question. OBS will give you live streaming. Live streaming is also possible in OBS. Now I think almost all questions I have answered. If I have not answered, please let me know which is the question I'll be answering. I think almost all common questions I have left. Other thing, almost all questions. Sir, in our class, sir, is it all our class can record using OBS? Definitely. Definitely you can record. There is no problem in recording, whether the class or anything, whether the live lectures that you are giving, whether anything that you are giving, it can get recorded. There is no problem. So if I have answered everything, I will be moving to the next thing. You can, if I have not answered anything, you can please ask me, how is noise removed? Again, that can be done. That can be done with the OpenShot editor. There is a button. Just like before starting recording, you can have a button for streaming. You see the streaming button, you can use it.
Sir, it was really wonderful session on e-video, I mean video development and content development. There are many questions pending, but that can be, you know, the participants are requested to be in touch with email through to sir, and they can get benefit of it. Now, sir, I request you to directly move on to the next session, that is e-assessment tools, because that is also as interesting as previous session. Okay, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So we are moving on to e-assessment. And again, there are different tools for e-assessment. Different tools for e-assessment. I think most of you are familiar with Kahoot. Kahoot is a very good tool. The tool creates very curiousness in the classroom, and active participation can also be encouraged in the classroom with Kahoot. I think many of you know that. You have got tools with quizzes. Many different tools we have. So I'll just take a recap of what are the available tools. What are the available tools? And after that, I will be going with two tools, if time permits. One, I will be going with Google Forms and how you can do online certification or auto-generated certification through Google Forms. And next, I will be going for this one, which is known as QSIS. So two different things which I have to give you. One is online certification using Google Forms, and another one is the thing which I have told you, which is QSIS. So just we are going with a tool for assessment. Now see, the first tool which I have told you, Kahoot. So this is the home page. Whatever, you can take a note of it. It's a very interesting tool. Previously, it has got only the synchronized way. Now it has made both synchronized and asynchronized. Asynchronized option came in that period of Corona. So Kahoot is one tool which you have to get familiar. Second one is QSIS. QSIZZ. QSIS. So this is a homepage of QSIS, which we are working with. Third one is TestMos. Again, the homepage I am showing here, it is for TestMos. Fourth one is Plickr. The Plickr is again very interesting tool. You want to generate cards. So when you generate cards, people will be showing their cards. And when they show their cards, by using your camera, you can just take a note of it. So that is Plickr. Now next one, H5. Have both the descriptive as well as objective type of assessment. And that tool is Socrative. So all these are e-assessment tools. Another tool is Hot Potatoes. So all these are e-assessment tools. So what I have told you, Kahoot, then QSIS, Socrates, Plickr, HYB, Hot Potatoes, all these things which are tools used for e-assessment. But the problem in e-assessment is that majority of the tools work with objective type of assessment. But some of the tools here work with descriptive type of assessment. But the problem is that at this point of time, we have to give certain notes or we have to give certain key points for a descriptive question. And by default, such key points will be recognized and auto default marking can be done. Sometimes, since human beings are more intelligent than technology, these key points will not come. So at that time, some of these tools will create some problem. So this is the problem with the descriptive mode of assessment, which the sum of the tools which are giving. But objective mode of assessment, since we are giving the correct answer, we are giving the answer key properly, so there won't be any difference in that. So Google Forms is also another tool which I am going to tell you. So today, we will be discussing about two different tools. One is Google Forms, because everyone knows Google Forms, and another one is QGIS. So Google Forms, I'll discuss Google Forms along with the e-certification. So we'll just see what is Google Forms and how you can you conduct QGIS through Google Forms, finally getting certified or the auto-generated certificate can be done. So this is a thing which we are looking here first. So everyone knows where you can go with the Google Forms. So just we are going with the Google Forms again. So what we are going with the Google Forms here, we have the Google Forms. Now everyone, most of the people, they are having their email ID, and everyone, I think almost everyone, we have our Gmail ID. In the Gmail, you see 9 buttons here. The 9 buttons here, when you click on the 9 buttons, it is the icon for Google Apps. When you click on the 9 buttons, all the different Google Apps will get opened. Now you can click on Drive. Now all your items which you have already loaded in the drive will be seen there. Now you can go with the new. Very simple thing. Since I'm going fast, little fast, because everyone knows this procedure. So when you click on new, automatically there are different icons which come. There you can go to more. Again, new different icons which you can see. There you can click on Google Forms. So once again, I'll tell you, the 9 dots on the right side of the Gmail ID, click on that. That is the Google Apps. There you can locate Drive, a triangle like thing. There you can locate a drive. When you come to the drive, there you see one plus. Click on the plus, new. You can just scroll or move your cursor down. You can just go to more. From there, you can go to Google Forms. Now, when you go to the Google Forms, a new form gets opened. New blank form gets opened. New blank form gets opened. You can give the name of the form and you can click on settings. Settings button is here on the top. First one button is theme, second button is preview, and third button is settings near to send. When you click on settings, you see general, presentation, QGIS. You can click on QGIS and make this a QGIS. You can activate, make this a QGIS and save. Make this a QGIS. Automatically, the QGIS form is getting generated. The QGIS form is getting generated. Now, nothing will be there in your scene. So don't think that this will be there. Nothing will be there in the scene. Now what you have to do? Now you have to click here. You have to click here. you have to click here. See the three different buttons here. You click on that. You see add-ons. Just to come down, click on add-ons. When you click on add-ons, different add-ons you will be seeing. When you click on add-ons, you see different add-ons. You scroll down, you will see an add-on called CertifyEM. Now, you just click on that. See, there is an option called install. You can see here. There is an option called install. You click on that. Then it will ask permission. By default, everyone is doing that. You click on continue. Now, it will ask about an account. You select your Google account. Now, there are a lot of things which will come. You have to allow. Allow the application, allow to send email, all those things, different icons which will come, you have to allow. So what I have told you, I'll repeat the process once again. Click on, just see my screen. Click on the three button near to the send, which you can see in your blank form. This is not a blank form, but it you can see in your blank form. Now, many different, first you will see undo, make a copy, all those things you will see, leave it. You can see add-on. Click on add-on. Many different add-ons will be opening. There you scroll little down. When you scroll little down, you will see an add-on called CertifyEM. Now you can click on that. Installation will start and click on install. So now they will ask, by default everything will ask permission and all. They will ask you for permission to install. You click on continue. After that, they will choose the account. You have to choose your account. Now, after that, you have to allow the add-on to act for everything. You click on allow. Then after that, by default, the add-on will be getting installed. So when the add-on is installed, see, you get a message, CertifyEM has been installed. Now go with the done. Now, see, you just see a change in your screen. You have CertifyEM. See, you have CertifyEM with an add-on. See the screen. You have CertifyEM with an add-on. Previously, it was absent in your screen. Now, by default, your Google form or your Gmail account, the add-on has been installed, and the add-on is for generating, auto-generating the certificate, which is known as CertifyEM. Now, see the form. We have an untitled form. In the untitled form, you double-click on untitled form, and you please type the name of the quiz. What you want to conduct? What program you want to conduct? You please type the name of the program by double clicking on untitled form. Now first one is untitled question. In the untitled question, what you can type? You can just type name of the applicant. So before that, what we will do? Just listen. We have reached to a stage where the add-on CertifyEM has been installed. Now we click on CertifyEM. Now there is a question comes, enable CertifyEM in this quiz. enable certify EM in this quiz. Now you click on certify EM. You click on that, enable certify EM in this quiz. You click on get started. You click on get started. When you click on get started, so what I have told, first click on certify EM, that symbol, then automatically it asks whether we need to enable certify EM for this quiz. You can select that. After selecting that, they ask, this window will come where you can just click on get started. When you click on get started, automatically the quiz, previously I have given online quiz, so the name comes as online quiz. In your case, there won't be any name coming, just it is coming like untitled form. So you can give the name there. Now, see the first one. See the first one. See the certify EM which is active here. On the right side, you certify EM. On the left side, you see the form. Now, first one, I have given name of the participant. Anything which you want. The understanding is that here, the type of the answer should be short answer text, because they will write their name or something. Because certificate should be produced in such a way that Dr. So-and-so or whatever, Mr. or Mrs. So-and-so has complete, if you want a designation, with the designation, has completed a program on with so-and-so. This is the format. So name of the participant we have taken. Second one, designation we have taken with a short answer. Now, if you want furthermore, like college, third one also you can keep with the college name. So first one, name of the participant. Second one, designation. Third one, name of the institution. Three things what I have kept it as short answer. Here I have kept only two. So three things you can keep it as short answer. Now, question starts. See the question starts. So in the question, by default, there will be one question, which is the color of the sky. This is the question format, which has been given in certify EM when it is active. So that you can change it to your question. So here what you can do, you can type the question. You can type the question. You can type the choice. After typing the choice, give the answer key. Here I have given the answer key and give the point. After giving the points, keep done. So whatever things, type the question, give the four or five different alternatives, click the right alternative, select the point, whether you want to give 1 point or 2 point, and finally keeping on, you give done. Now, when you keep done, they ask you whether it is a compulsory question. There you select required. So once again, I'm telling, type the question here, the space given, see the type of the question, multiple choice. You can select and change it to any type of the question, true or false, checkbox, anything. You can make it. See the alternatives, click on the right alternative, answer key you can give and give the marks. Then required means compulsory. So this is the first question. Now I prepare three questions. Just like that. Now, questions are done like this. Now, what you can do in certify EM? Certify EM, you can click on accept the terms and service. That will be here. You can click on accept the terms and service. When you click on that, it will come a window like this. Please wait. On that, the certification is turned on. Turn on. Now, see, you can keep the passing percentage for pass. Passing percentage, you can click here. You can make it 50, 60, 80, or whatever it is. You can select the template of the certificate from here. So what all things? Passing percentage you can keep. Template you can keep. And actually, auto default templates are available. If you want to do that, you can do that. You can select that. Otherwise, there is an option called customize our own certificate. There you can customize your own certificate. But thing is that the certificate that you are going to customize should be from the presentation, Google presentation sheet. It is not from image. It is not from any other form of thing. It is also from the presentation with a certain text. Now, we are turning on. Now see this. I have just made certification is on. Just clicking on that, I have made certification is on. Passing percentage, I have kept it as 60%. Template of the certificate, I have selected as red ribbon. See, any template, I'm choosing one. Now, if you want to have an understanding on how you can customize your certificate, you can click on help. And you can understand that also. Now, everything is done. This is an advanced option, which I'm not keeping. I'm just keeping as such by default. I'm going for save changes. Now, first question is over. Now, if I want to add second question, I can go with the plus button here. If I want to keep something, see, second question is added using plus button. See, second question I have added. Moodle is a learning management system. It's a question I have added. Third question I have added again using the plus button. And I kept it as required, means compulsory. Fourth question, what I have done? I have taken a question from the form. I have taken a question from the form using the second button. Using the second button, see, this is a button. I click on this button. I have used, I have selected a questions from the form. You can select questions from already available Google Forms. See, the questions will be reflected here. You can choose the question and click on import question. Questions will be reflected. You can choose the question and import question. Now questions are coming. See the question. The fourth question also came. Now, if you want to make section, you can keep this one. Now, if you want to import image, now I made section 2 with this button. Now, if I want to import an image, I'm clicking on image. I'm selecting images from the photos I'm selecting in my system. Now, I have inserted the image. After inserting, I am adding a video. Again, I click on the video icon. I have given a URL and the video also selected. And finally, video also added. So I have used this button for adding new question. Second button for importing question from the other Google form. Third button for keeping the different section, part A, part B, like that. Fourth one for inserting an image. Fifth one for inserting a video. And the last one for generating the section. This was the subheading, this was a section. So now section 2 of 2 will be coming. So every icon in the Google form are utilized for generating different types of questions. Now what is the next stage? So we have prepared a clear questionnaire with a different set of questions. Now I'm going to the theme. I'm clicking on the theme. I'm selecting theme color. See, the form themes and all will be changed according to the color I select. Now I select the font also. Here I have selected playful font. So the font also getting changed. See, background color also getting changed. Everything I have done. Now I'm going to preview. I just preview my quiz. So this is the view where my quiz will be available for others. So I have done the preview. After that, I click once again to stop the preview. Now I have clicked on settings. We started with clicking on settings to keep the quiz. Now we again click on settings. We select collect email address and limit to one response. Why we have to limit? Sometimes people will go on responding many different times so that you will get many number of responses and the actual number is very difficult to find out. So from one mail ID, we limit to one responses. Now we have to go to presentation. Presentation, we just select progress bar and one more, anything you can select. All these things function differently. And one confirmation message also. If somebody have submitted, they also should know that they have submitted it properly. So we have given a confirmation message your response had been recorded. Thank you. So, and we click on save. Now QSOS, we have already gone. I told you previously. So that also we keep on save. After that, we go to send. The sent button here. In the sent button, you see, it will be there like this. You can directly send to the mail. We go to the link. So the second one we go. And when you go that, you will get a very long link. Very long Google form link. You click on shorten URL. You click on shorten URL. The link will be shortened. Now you copy. And after that, you just send to the people. Now, for making our custom template, see, this is the thing. First line should be full name. It should be taken like this. Second line should be title of the Google quiz. Third line should be other optional identifier. Identifier means like designation, number, register number, etc., etc. Then other lines also keep like that. If you want to keep date, all these things which are given here, you can just go through. The format is given. With that format, you can keep, you can design your slide. You can keep and design your slide. Now see, by default, the certificate will be generated. The certificate will be generated. And finally, you can use different types of certifications. Now, so what I have done, I have just created a Google form and I have added an add-on. What is that add-on? Add-on was CertifyM. So now finally, when I send the link, when I send the URL to a WhatsApp group or to some mail IDs, people start responding on my quiz. When they respond, now see, you have kept it as 80% or 60% as a percentage of pass. If they could able to pass, automatically the certificate that you design will be coming to their mail without any problem. If they can pass, means you have kept it as 60%. If they could able to get 60%, the certificate which you have customized, which you have made for your own program or your own classes, that will be automatically coming to the candidate's mail ID. So this is what is the thing. So what we have done, we, everyone knows, most of the people knows how to create a Google form. But where we lag, I'm talking the clear way. Everyone, I think most of you know how you can create a Google form. But you may not be knowing how you can create an auto-generated certificate. It's a simple icon. Before starting with your blank form, what are we doing here? We are adding an add-on. We are keeping an add-on. And what is that add-on? Add-on is CertifyM. Add-on gives you provision to take default certificate from its list. Different set of certificates are there. Add-on takes you provision to keep the percentage of pass according to your convenience. Add-on will link the queues. And even leaving all those things, add-on provide you with an understanding that you can also customize your own certificate. But the understanding, you should take it in the sense that it should not be a JPEG form. It should not be .avi form or any other form. It should be of the form of the presentation form, Google form, Google presentation form. So when you keep add-on, by default, once the program is completed, students will receive certificate in the mail ID which they have asked. Now I'll tell you one more thing. If you want to keep some security for that, see, every certificate will be generated with some unique number. For example, 500 people are participating. So 500 different number will be generated for certificate. And as an organizer, if I am conducting the program, all the data of these certificates will be there in my Google Drive. In my Google Drive, which I have initiated the quiz or which I have initiated the exam. So what I can do, when you disperse a certificate to the owner, to the participant, you can just keep one simple thing. You can just keep some scanner or something. Like you can just attach some something like you can attach any reader to their certificate. So for example, the barcode reader or anything you can attach, or RFID you can attach, or anything you can attach, so that the originality of the certificate can be checked at any time. So all these things are available in the Google form. That is what I want to communicate. So what I have done, it is a simple one which we normally use, but we use sometimes without add-on. Here just I have asked you to keep an add-on and proceed. And while keeping an add-on, first two lines are auto-generated where it takes name and designation or something. If you want to have further lines, all these things you can preset, where the choice should be or the response type should be of short answer type. So this is the way by which we generate or we make an auto-generated certificate. Now, you can add QR code. Somebody was asking about QR code. QR code can be added to the certificate. QR code can be added to the certificate, and with that QR code, you can check whether the certificate which you have issued are original or not. Somebody has duplicated or not. Those things can also be done. So now I will go with another software, which is known as QSIS. Again, QSIS is an online evaluation software. I'll just go with that. And after that, I'll take the questions from both Google form and auto generation plus QSIS. Now, just we will work with QSIS. QSIS, what I have told, QSIS is again a tool. QS. Now, for that purpose, what you have to do, same as above, same as we do previously, you have to just Google QSIS.com or QSIS. When you just Google QSIS, automatically you will be taken to QSIS site where you'll see QSIS.com. See QSIS.com, join a game. You can click on that. Now, if you are for the first time, they will ask you to sign up. Click on sign up. You'll see sign up here. Click on sign up. Now, by default, you will be going to the QSIS page. Now, you can sign up with Gmail ID and all. Those things you know, everyone knows. Finally, you will reach to the homepage. So what we have done, we have simply Googled QSIS. After Googling QSIS, we have gone to the QSIS official site, which is known as QSIS.com. After going to that site, what we have done, we have for the first time, if you are there in the site, you have to go with sign up. You click on sign up. By default, you can go for sign up with Gmail and all. And after completing that, you will be there in the homepage. Now see the homepage. In the homepage, see when you sign up, you will get a teacher dashboard. A teacher dashboard. See the teacher dashboard. You click on teacher dashboard. Now you will get this screen with different activities. See, find a quiz, my quizzes, reports, classes, collections, settings, logout, etc., and create a new quiz. So I'm going with the create a new quiz. I click on create a new quiz. they ask the name. I just simply given the name as technology quiz. See, now they will ask the different class. I have selected the class as educator professional development, which I have already given. When I am signing up, I have given my class as educator and professional development. So I have selected that. Now I have click on next. It goes to the next screen with different questions type. See, I can go with the multiple choice. I can go with the checkbox. I can go with fill in the blanks or poll or open-ended type of questions. Now I simply take multiple choice. I click on multiple choice. Now see, multiple choice question is coming here. I'm giving my first question: out of the following, which is not a video creation software? Now, the options also I have given: PowerSoft, Screencastify, all those things. Right option also I have marked. See, seconds also I have just changed. By default, it will be 30 seconds. I have made it as 20 seconds and I save the question. So what all things I have done? See, the question has been given here. Alternatives are given. Right option has been selected. Time has been selected. Then I see the mobile view of my quiz. See, this is the mobile view of my quiz. Then I click on save. Now, see, I have done. Now I have gone for the question two. I have typed a question or copied and pasted a question. Choices are given. Right choice has been marked. Time has been selected. And I click on save. So two questions I have completed. Now I click on done. If you have 10 questions, you can go with the 10. If you have 50, you can go with 50, anything. Now I just simply kept two. Now I kept on done. Now see, this is a quiz which is coming for me. I can edit. I can edit and I can do anything which I want. When I click on done, they ask the quiz name. So if I want to give some image, I have given an image, just clicking and inserting. Then I select the language as English. I select the grade to which people this quiz belongs to, means university level. Then who can see the quiz? I have just selected public, visible to everyone, and save. Image has been added. Language has been selected. Grade has been designed and open to all. I have kept. Now I click on save. Now, after doing that, I have the quiz ready with me. Now, the playing mode, there are three different modes. One is a team mode, which people can go with the team and play. And the one is classic mode. Classic mode means every individual participant will be taken individually. Then third one is test mode. So I just click on classic mode. I just click on classic mode and I click on continue. When I click on classic mode or any mode and I click on continue, automatically the playing option comes. So what is the playing option? I should ask my students, I should ask my learners, I should ask my participants to just Google joinmyquiz.com. joinmyquiz.com in their mobile. Just Google joinmyquiz.com in their mobile. When they Google joinmyquiz.com, it asks a code. So the code is here 990. So for every game, the code will be changing. Now, if I start here, means the quiz is going to start. So I will be waiting for my students to join. See, waiting for the students to join. When students are joined, when all the students are joined, I can start the game. And this is a synchronized mode. I can start the game. Automatically, the countdown comes 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And finally, the queue starts. Here, see, this is a teacher dashboard. This is a teacher dashboard. I see my counts will be coming like here. Only one player, so it is coming like this. So if you have any number of players, it will be reflected here. Now, finally, the questions are answered, everything has been given, and the first position or second position, everything will be noted. So this will be like this. Now, results can be downloaded in an Excel sheet. Now, this is what you are creating a quiz by adding questions one by one. Now you can find a quiz, or before that, the same quiz can be given as an assignment also. Without playing live, without going for a live mode of playing, you can just assign it as a homework. So click on homework, assign homework, it asks the date and time when you want to give it. You select the date, select the time or everything and click on continue. So again, one code will be generated. You can and the link will be generated. If people want to go with that, either they can join myquiz.com, they can go directly and they can type this code, or they can click on the link. Two ways they can join. One, they can go to joinmyquiz.com and type the code directly, or get the link. So anyway, they can do that. Now copy the link and finally you can just give find a quiz. So when you find a quiz, when you want to get a quiz, the auto default quiz which is already available, you can click on find. You can just take the quiz from this site. So what all things are working? Create new quiz we have already done. Find in that create new quiz what we have done. I just have shown two different modes. One is what? One is a synchronized mode of quizzing, which is known as play live. And another one is asynchronized mode, which is known as giving a homework. Second one, we are finding a quiz from the already available database here. You can select any subject, you will get quiz icon. You can select and import to your quiz. Third one, you can see reports, you can create classes, all these things are there. So all these things work well when it comes to quizzes.com. So quizzes.com is working in an area where what we are talking about the quizzes.com. We just tell you, quizzes.com works in a teacher mode in the case as quizizz.com, where you have to create an account and where you have to create the quiz and you can run the quiz. When you want your students to join for the quiz, either you can share the link or you can ask them to joinmyquiz.com. Joinmyquiz.com and type the code. Same which works in Kahoot. In the case of Kahoot, as a teacher, we work in Kahoot.com. We work in Kahoot.com, and for the learner, they work in Kahoot.it. So when we work in teacher Kahoot.com, it asks a pin, and that pin will be generated by the teacher and is given to Kahoot.it. So with that pin, people will be connected. Here it comes in joinmyquiz.com. Again, it is a pin, we call it just a call. So these are the two different e-assessment tools which I have discussed today. One is Google Form and how you can generate, how you can create an auto-generated certificate. And the second one, how you can conduct a quiz using quizzes.com. So if you have any doubt regarding any of the things that I have discussed, you can please ask to me. I'll be responding to you.
Joshit, sir, you can see the chat, yeah. Question answer.
Yeah. So, yeah, here in QSIS, yeah, you can make to any users. When you are working on QSIS, you can make to any users. There is no problem. Yeah, there's a question which is a relevant question. How to train students and teachers from rural areas? See, all these online technology, the basic is with internet base. Even sometimes we may get connected and we may not. All depends on bandwidth of net and all. So for rural areas, the problem is that where there is no internet, we cannot work with technology. That is a basic understanding. But if you have areas where people are trained, there without going for a live demo or without going for a live interaction, you can have an asynchronous mode of interaction using slides and other things which you have prepared already. So, how to reduce the size of the video created, all those things you can do. Size option is there. There you can select that size. One size we have kept auto default. You can select a smaller size. So I think I... Yeah, you can directly select a QR code in a Certify-EM. You can directly add that. There is no problem in that. How to assess descriptive type of, yeah, in some of the tools, for example, some tools, they will give you descriptive type of questions where they ask for key points. But I have told you already, if they respond in such a way that the responses are right, but these key points are not attended, means there the tool will go in a wrong way. If you can give, as a teacher, if you can give all the different key points, means that will be fine. It can be assessed based on the key point. Means for every key point, you will give certain marks. For example, 1 mark or half mark, which you can set. With that, they will be assessing. What does it mean? You have drive.google.com refused to connect. No problem, sir. You can go to your Gmail account and you can click on Drive. It will be connecting. There is no problem. Yeah, whether the certificate display the exact percentage of score. Yeah, if you keep 80% as the pass mark, and if you get a 90%, it will display 90%. But if you have lower than that, it will not display. Yeah, Certify-EM is attached as an add-on to Google Form. So it will work in Google Form. If you can keep the some feedback form, can be kept it in Google Form. It will work for Google Form. You can keep any type of feedback form using Google Form, and you can attach Certify-EM with that. So select the QR code, just
hello, Joshit sir.
Jyotsna, has the audio gone?
Joshit,
the audio seems to have gone.
Yeah, I'm trying to contact.
I think it's a problem with his internet.
Yes, sir.
Audio is gone.
He's trying, sir.
Oh, there's a power cut, I think, on his end.
Yes, ma'am, it's power cut on his
screen. Yeah, that's what's coming on the screen.
He's trying to connect, yes.
I got disconnected.
Yeah.
Okay, any other questions? Ma'am, you can just tell which are the questions which I can respond. Since I got disconnected, I will not see the previous questions. It will be there in the previous chat box.
Acha, okay.
So many of them, they were asking about this compatibility in the mobile as well as this Windows system.
There is no problem in that, because if you have the clear software to read the Excel sheet, then it will be working in the mobile. Has we need to have something like a Kingsoft Office or something which reads all the different apps, then it will be working properly. There is no compatibility issue there. But better if you are being an administrator, start with the desktop or the start with the laptop, so that your customization and other things are very clear. Mobile only you can use it as a participant. That will be the better view.
There was one question related to other certificate related add-ons if available.
Yeah, can we insert our certificate in CertifyM? You can insert the certificate, but the certificate should be in such a format which I have told. Because CertifyM will read only the presentation mode, means the Google, that sheet only it will be reading. It should, and your certificate should not be in a JPEG form, just like an image form, it will not read. So that format, if it is there, it will read. Once you click on CertifyM, you understand that what all things, how you can give names and all these are very simple. The first line will read name, second line will read designation or whatever we give. Third line will read college or register number, anything you can keep it. And fourth line will go for if you want program, just like you can keep anything.
Dr. Joshi, there's a question coming that is there certification in quizzes? It's coming in again and again.
Certification? No.
In quizzes.
Quizzes, we don't have auto-generate certification.
Yeah, that's what they're asking. Yeah.
Quizzes is a separate tool. They don't have auto generation. Quizzes is same like Kahoot. Kahoot, Quizzes, Socrates, Plickr, all those are different types of thing. In that Plickr, we need cards. And it's interesting to play with the card. But only the problem is that you cannot create at once, because you need to have an understanding that how many people are participating. And on the prior end, you need to keep cards. Here in Kahoot or Plickr, the same question can be used in 1,000 menus, because only thing is that you need to log in and you need to start playing. That's the difference between Quizzes that you can do, Kahoot that you can do, but in Plickr you need certain prefixed cards.
So there is one question related to where do we check the responses of the quiz taker?
Yeah, when you have Quizzes, if you are asking with the Quizzes, means you will have reports. In the reports, you will get an Excel sheet where you will get details of every quiz taker. If you are asking with the other thing, Google form, in your drive, the person who is conducting the quiz, in his drive, you will have an Excel sheet. And in the Excel sheet, the details of the responses will be given, the certification will be given, everything will be generated very clearly in the sheet.
So many of them, they were asking about how can we add digital signature in the Google form.
There is an option, ma'am. There is a clear option to add digital signature. You can just see in that settings. So just we are working with one thing. One or other options you can click, and there is an option to add. You should have a signature customized first, and you can just import in that. You can add. Simple thing. All these. See, this is a workshop. I'll tell you. This is a workshop where just like research, you can say, you cannot say the like that. You have to go with the trial and error. So for everyone, I'm saying you have to go with the trial and error, and all options are available. Today, I have just told you about OBS, but I told only the basic thing, how you can just streamline an audio, a video. But thing is that there are a lot of advanced settings which you have to click on each settings and see the changes. So same thing in the Google Form also. See, spreadsheets are there, collaborative spreadsheets are there. All those works in Google Form very well. And same this now we are working on a quiz. You are making the quiz and you want to make me also as a host. So it will work in a collaborative mode. So e-certification also can be collaboratively done. So all these works well here. So I think almost all questions have been responded, and some of the questions, especially those related to the settings and all, I kindly request the participants to go with the settings, or if they have any problem, if they are not getting when they are working alone, if they have any problem, they can contact, we will be resolving that. There is no issue in that. They can contact me at any time and we will be resolving that. But please do for the first time, try to check and then call. Because normally the tendency is that people without checking, they will be asking a lot of things. Please try to check. It can be done properly.
Thank you very much, sir. I think this is the first webinar. They have got a lot of homework to be done. Because now whatever you have taught today, they will definitely work, because they have joined the webinar. They wanted to learn. So thank you very much, Joshit sir. It was very, very enlightened session. We have learned two new softwares and even e-assessment tools. And I would like to inform to the participants also that tomorrow, the sessions which are there, we are going to have a live demo of Kahoot interactive session, because today deliberately we have not kept that, because tomorrow we are going to have a session on web tools for collaborative learning. So we will see that how exactly a teacher in a synchronous mode go with students also. So a student sitting in any corner of the country can be connected to you in a synchronous mode. So thank you, sir. It was really wonderful thing. And tomorrow we will be again meeting at 3:00. And tomorrow we have with us Dr. Thiago. And he is going to deal with web tools for collaborative learning. And he'll be enlightening us for certain mobile applications, which we can use as a teacher in the classrooms. So thank you once again. There are many questions in the chat box and on the Facebook pages related to, sir, are you ready to conduct workshops with us? We are ready to learn. So Joshit sir, you can think of on that line. And you have received 1.2K comments on this live video streaming, which is going on the Facebook. There are more than 303 people who are connected with us on Facebook page. And in Telegram group, we have 507 people right now with us. Now I request all the participants, if you have any doubts, we will enable you to ask questions in the Telegram group. Joshit sir is member there and he will respond to your queries there. That is only for 1 or 2 hours. And then we'll again mute you all for that. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow at 3:00. Have a nice day.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah,
thank
Dr. Joshit, I called you from your Central University of Kerala. You're from Nagaland University.
No. I understand.
You were talking about Dr. Amrut and I got confused in the process. Sorry for that.
I was from Central University of Kerala till March 16th. I just joined.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I got confused when I said. Sorry for that.
Nothing like that. I understand. So thank you very much, Patel sir. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much. And all those, Bhumika ma'am, Jyotsna ma'am, and all the other organizers, I thank from my side. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.